Hello, America. I'm Mark Levin. This is Life, Liberty, and Levin with our great guest, Heather MacDonald. How are you?
Fine, thank you, Mark. Thank you for having me on.
Well, you have a BA and MA in English. You have a JD. You're a lawyer. But you're a scholar in so many areas, race relations, immigration, policing, and colleges and universities. And this is where I really wanted to delve in with you. You have a brand new book, The Diversity Delusion, How Race and Gender Pandering Corrupt the University and Undermine Our Culture. This is so relevant today. And you argue that toxic ideas first spread by higher education have undermined humanistic values, fueled intolerance, and widened divisions in our larger culture. And I think we see this everywhere now.
We certainly do. Yeah. The Kavanaugh hearings was an example that we're all in Gender Studies 101 now, Mark. Virtually every aspect of the culmination of hysteria that greeted Judge Kavanaugh was perfected over the last decade on a college campus. Above all, the preposterous mantra to believe survivors, regardless of the evidence, regardless of due process. This is the campus rape hysteria that has been transforming the lives of males on campuses, creating an extraordinarily costly bureaucracy, moved into the real world, and it's not going away. It's only going to get worse.
What have our universities and colleges become, and when did this happen? I mean, they were always kind of liberal in the last several decades, but in some ways, and not my phrase, now they're almost sort of a Soviet-style system where there really isn't free speech. You're not allowed to challenge the so-called norms in the universities, where race and gender seem to have a priority over other things and that sort of thing. When did all this happen?
Well, the 80s was when it started, in my view. That's when you got radical multiculturalism that hit. I was in college in the 70s. I'm very grateful for that because I was allowed to read John Milton, William Wordsworth, and Shakespeare without anyone thinking to complain about the gonads and melanin of those authors. I got to lose myself in beauty, in greatness, and sublimity. Come the 80s, and students were given a license for ignorance. They were taught that the only thing they needed to know about a book was the race and gender of the author to know whether it was thoroughly dismissible without even being read, and they could go on to instead wallow in their own delusional oppression. And it has only gotten worse since then. And what we are doing is breeding the grounds for, I fear, civil war, because students are being taught to hate the greatest works of Western civilization, and frankly, to hate each other. From the moment a student steps on college campus today as a freshman, or a fresh person, I should probably say, the bureaucracy is determined to drum into that student's head identity politics, which says he's either a victim or an oppressor. Oppressors are obviously, most famously, white males, heterosexual white males. The only way they can get out of their oppressor category is to become an ally of the oppressed. The most preposterous delusion of all of this is students actually believe that they are at risk of their lives from circumambient racism and sexism on a college campus. This is an environment that, in traditional liberal terms, is the most tolerant environment in human history for society's traditionally marginalized groups. Yet there's a massive bureaucracy dedicated to cultivating in students this delusional sense of their own oppression, which then they carry with them. It's a chip on their shoulder that prevents them from seizing the magnificent opportunities to learn, to read every book that's ever been written. And they carry this chip, this delusional victimology, into the world at large. And they are going around blaming American institutions of endemic racism and sexism when that no longer is true.
You see it with respect to professors and tenure. You see certain professors are sort of drummed out of the classroom. You see the rise in confrontation, physical confrontation on college campuses. You see that the commencement speakers are almost totally of the left. And you see when some conservatives dare to go to a college campus and want to speak about things that are really not particularly controversial, how often you have to bring in the riot police or the security guards have to come into the facility. The administrators, are these the old 60s, 1960s retread types, or who are these people?
Yeah, the administrators are even more left-wing than the faculty. And they are part of this massive bureaucracy. If students are wondering, why is my college tuition so expensive? Look no further than the diversity bureaucracy. At the University of California at Los Angeles, their vice chancellor for equity, diversity, and inclusion makes over $400,000 a year. This is mind-boggling. This is multiples more than your average faculty member makes. It could pay for free tuition for 4 years for 12 undergraduates. And that vice chancellor of equity, diversity, inclusion has nothing to do, because there isn't a single bigot on a university campus today. Every faculty search is one desperate effort to find qualified females or so-called underrepresented minorities, this refers to blacks and Hispanics, who haven't already been snapped up by better endowed schools. So what do the vice chancellors of diversity, equity, inclusion do? Because they're certainly not routing circumambient racism and sexism. What they're doing is drumming into students' head this false narrative of victimology. And what is amazing to me is that colleges are somehow held harmless for their rising tuitions. The solution that's always bandied about in public discourse is, well, more federal aid. No, don't feed the beast. Cut the bureaucracy, get back to the basics of learning, which now is a distant afterthought. No faculty has the guts to say, we know what you should learn, you're ignorant, we're here to put knowledge in your empty noggins. Instead, students are given utter carte blanche to decide what to study. The faculty have abdicated their intellectual responsibility. And as you say, we're in a very weird situation where speakers such as myself, who was prevented from talking about policing at Claremont McKenna College, when I need a police escort to come onto a college campus, an alarm bell should be going off in the faculty's ears saying, something's wrong here. But instead, the faculty are nowhere to be found.
Let me ask you this. So why do we passively subsidize this? Through our taxes, through tuition, through student loans? You know, you have Bernie Sanders out there saying, free college for everybody. Well, of course, these are, as you're saying, more indoctrination mills, right, more than anything else. So free college and Obama with, you know, the federal government should assume all the student debt. So they talk about college as if it really is academic rather than, in so many respects, propaganda-oriented. They know about this, then. They know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. It bleeds into the greater society, doesn't it? It bleeds into politics. It bleeds into the media. Some of the things you're talking about, I see in the media. I see with anchors on TV. I see with commentators on TV.
Well, identity politics is everywhere. I am so sick of hearing somebody preface his remarks by saying, well, as a white female or as a black female, X, Y, Z. I'm sorry, that's a non sequitur. It is not the case that I can predict your views knowing that you're a white male. I cannot predict your views if you were a black female. And it is the height of both arrogance and condescension to think that somebody can be typecasted on the basis of that. But of course, that is now the currency of the political realm. So it has certainly bled into politics. The Democratic Party now is an extension of this poisonous identity politics on college campuses. And to be honest, I can only hope it continues, because Americans by and large are not buying it. But the thing that worries me the most, Mark, is what this is doing to our scientific advantage in the so-called STEM fields. This is the science, technology, engineering, and math. For a while, people who were optimists thought, well, okay, You got the gender studies here. You got the women's studies there. You got the Chicana studies there. It's all going to stay put. Science will be the one realm that remains committed to meritocracy, because we all understand, of course, that there's no such thing as female physics. There's no such thing as Iranian physics. There's physics. There's math. This is the accomplishment of human reason that is open to everybody. Well, that was a false hope. Anybody that knew anything about the university would have known it's not safe. And now you have nothing less than the National Science Foundation, a federal agency that is the premier funder of basic research on college campuses, that has itself been colonized by this poisonous identity politics. The National Science Foundation is spending billions of our taxpayer dollars funding gender theorists on college campuses to study so-called intersectionality and microaggressions in the STEM fields, on the assumption that the only possible explanation for why we do not have 50-50 gender parity in our engineering departments and math departments must be, by definition, the result of sexism. That is the diversity delusion. That is the fundamental lie that we've been fed, that any disparity in a representation, whether it's a gender disparity or race disparity, must be the result of discrimination. And so our STEM fields now are obsessed with gender equity and race equity.
So it also is an attack, as you write, on competition, obviously.
Right.
And on merit.
It is.
And so we kind of dumb down our society. We tribalize our society. We balkanize our society. Who does this benefit?
Well, it benefits the bureaucracy, because let's start again with the college campus, but it goes into corporations as well. On a college campus, students are being taught to hate. They're being taught to think of themselves as victims. I would argue, this is a side issue we can get or can't get into, racial preferences, which are a poisonous policy, feed into this in complex ways. But every time that students hold these protests, like brown students occupying the president's office saying, well, it's very hard to have to go to class and study for exams because we're working so hard at, quote, staying alive at Brown. This is preposterous. This is delusional. But every time there's a little outbreak of student hysteria, the diversity bureaucracy walks in and says, well, we need more diversity bureaucrats. And sadly, the students agree, and they inevitably ask for more vice chancellors of equity, diversity.
But you also brought up the Kavanaugh hearings. And so what I'm getting at is, when you indoctrinate people this way,
right,
when you affect their thinking this way, I mean, eventually they leave college and mm-hmm. they leave a university.
Sure.
And they go out into the broader world. And I feel like the Democrat Party plays into this. I feel like the Democrat Party plays into this. More and more the media play into this, because a lot of these people in politics more and more and in the media more and more come out of this mindset, do they not?
Well, yeah, the media believes, again, that race and gender determine everything. There's not a single mainstream media outlet that is not determining what stories to cover, who to source them to, who to quote, who to write them, that is not looking at race and gender on the assumption that those attributes determine our world, that America is profoundly racist, profoundly sexist, and they're seeking stories that they think support that narrative. And it's also in corporations, HR departments. You know, one of the main milestones that show how much the university identity politics is transforming our competitive edge was when Google fired a young computer engineer named James Damore in August of 2017. Damore wrote a factual, reasoned-based 10-page memo simply questioning the feminist orthodoxy that reigns at Google. He was fired. Well, one of the interesting comments on the Google chat board said, we need to stop this diversity madness before it goes any further. Right now, our HR department is simply an outpost of gender studies and black studies.
All right. Don't forget, folks, almost every weeknight you can watch Levin TV. I'll be there at crtv.com. We'd love you to join us. Just give us a call at 844-LEVIN-TV, 844-LEVIN-TV.